Hi, this is Shomik Bishwas. You are attending my class of that digital communication system. Today's topic is the criteria for the best decision. It is the second lecture of that signal space analysis, and today's objective is find out the criteria for that best decision. So the criteria for the best decision. So what is best? Number one, what is best here? Minimization of the average probability of symbol error. Minimization of the average probability of the symbol error. Now the PE is the average probability of the symbol error. So it can be shown as PI into P. So here PI is the associated probability of that particular message. Here PE equals to summation of I equals to 1 to M PI cross P M cap not equals to MI by MI. It means we are taking right here, this is called that conditional probability, and basically here we are using that PMF, probability mass function, we are using right here. So actually why it is taken as a probability mass function right here? Because the symbol error what you are taking inside, it is taken as a discrete in nature, so therefore that signal probability is in that form of not continuous RV, it is called the discrete RV. So this particular fashion has been taken. What is the second point? That is, it is optimum in that minimum probability of error sense. So minimum probability of error, if you are considering this particular one, so obviously it is optimum in the minimum probability of error sense. Number three, based on this criteria, we begin to design the receiver that can give the best decision. So what is the main features? That minimization of the average probability of the symbol error, we'll trying to find out the best. And it is optimum in the minimum probability of error sense, that best criteria. And based on this criteria, we begin to design the receiver that can give the best decision. Now, geometric representation of signals. So how geometrically one signal can be represented out of this? So here one signal space concept is basically based upon few factors like vectorization of the discrete or continuous signals that removes the redundancy in signals and provides a compact representations for them. So what is redundancy? What is the meaning of redundant? Redundancy means one signal may appear many more times in a particular channel. So the redundancy if less, so the signal will be accepted, can be received in much more better way. But if redundancy increase, the signal losses increase. So the lossy transmission line, the lossy media, if used for the signal transmission and the reception, the redundancy will carry a high factor in this particular cases. So vectorization, or that making some x and y perpendicular vector concept, actually in that 3D perception, if you are seeing one particular signal, so it may be continuous, it may be discrete, but the vectorization will keep that redundancy small in that signal analysis. Okay. Now the next part is the determination of the vectorization basis. Now, if you want to make vector in a particular signaling, so how to do this? Actually, you have to use that Gram-Smith orthogonalization procedure. Here, that Gram-Smith, that particular process of that orthogonalization is basically finding out OB. OB means orthonormal basis on that part of given basis. So generally, what is the Gram-Smith is doing? You have to have that previously given some basis. Now that basis is suppose given as b1, b2, b3, and the vector which you have to find out, that OB, it means orthonormal basis on which you have to find out, it is given as v. And now you have to find out the orthonormal basis or that OB of that given b upon that given bias. So you have to find out the orthonormal bias. Here, if it is taken as alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, so there is a particular rule how we can convert that given bias up to this alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. Okay, in a particular separate slide I have given a detailed example numerically and solve it out using that Gram-Smith criteria, so I will come to it later. Now here is a procedure of Gram-Smith orthogonalization process. What is the procedure here? That here given v1, v2 up to vk, they are the different vectorial point or that given vector which is in the form of linear matrix. So obviously we can write v equals to bracket of v1, v2, v3 up to vk. Here one exclamatory sign is shown on the top of every corner, this one, actually this representing that v cap, that is v2 cap. In this way, that vi, v2, v3 up to vk. So how to find an orthonormal basis or OB, what I am telling, that is called that OB, orthonormal basis. How to find out OB from them? So how to find that OB from them? So here, now what I am telling to you actually, that particular V1, V2 up to VK is a set of basis of their orthonormal basis upon which you have to find it out. So how to find out alpha 1? Alpha 1 equals to v1 by mod v. What is v1? That v1 is already given to you in that form of basis. And what is the mod of v1? Mod of v1 means whatever v1 you have to calculate. Now you have to find out mod v1. It means that lower one, that mod v1. Mod v1 is basically mod v1 into mod v1. So if you are multiplying them, so obviously whatever the final output, it is mod v1 square. You'll be getting something like this. So obviously taking that root of this one, we'll be getting out the final one. So you will be getting that mod v1. So obviously that mod v1 will be replaced in this particular diagram. So in the particular mathematical example which I have shown to you, I will make it more clear to this. I will come that particular orthogonalization procedure after that particular lecture. In that next lecture it will be there. So in step 2, what I did, in step 2 we have to find out what is the value of alpha 2. Here it is given as u2. In my lecture I give it at alpha 2 and this one I gave it as alpha 1. So alpha 2 is what? Or u2 equals to v2 minus v2 minus v2 minus v2 dot u1 into u1. Here that v2 is basically that b2 or that v2. So here this v2 is given, so v2 that is multiplied with that u1 and u1. So you have to get that u2. So U2 is also U2 divided by mod U2. Here alpha 2 equals to basically beta 2 gamma 2 by mod gamma 2. So what is gamma 2? Gamma 2 equals to beta 2 minus beta 2 into alpha 1 into alpha 1. So in the same way, if you are finding out U3, so what is the value of U3? U3 equals to gamma 3 by mod gamma 3. So what is the value of mod gamma 3? Gamma 3 equals to B3 minus B3 alpha 1 minus B3 alpha 2 alpha 2. In this way, you have to find out gamma 3. Now in the same way, you can find out gamma 4, you can find out gamma 5. So what is the step 3 for I equals to 3, 4, 5, 6? Let Ui equals to Vi minus Vi dot Ui minus 1, Ui minus 1. So again Vi dot Ui minus 2, I minus 2 up to the last. So set Ui equals to basically Ui by mod of Ui. So therefore that Ui, it means U1, U2, U3 up to UK forms that orthogonal basis. Properties is what? That the vector, when you are considering that vector V is a matrical form of V1 to Vn, that inner product is basically the dot product. Dot product means we have to multiply the X vector with that X vector component. Suppose Ai plus Bj plus C omega, or Ai plus Bj plus Ck is given, one vector. Another vector is Pi plus Qj plus Rk. So you have to multiply K with K, J with J, and I with I. So X axis must be multiplied with X axis, Y axis must be multiplied with that Y axis, and the corresponding Z must be multiplied with the Z axis if we are considering the dot product. So whatever the inner product is considering in that previous slide, it must be the dot product. Now if we are having one dot product, that is V A dot B, you know that you can write A dot B means that is A B obviously with that value of cos theta. So A, B, cos theta. Now if they are orthogonal to each other, so that inner product must be equals to 0. Why? Because the cos theta, if the cos 90 degrees projected, so obviously A, B cos 90 degree equals to 0. So the dot product must be equals to 0, or the orthogonal if they are, their inner product must be equals to 0. What is the number 4? That is the norm. How to find out the norm? That mod V equals to root over of V1 square plus V2 square plus V3 square in this way up to Vn square. How we have to find out that gamma? Actually in that given lecture I have shown you these things. Now the next part is the ortho normal. What is the ortho's normal? That is, if the inner product is 0 and the individual norm is 1, this is called ortho's normal. So the sixth point is linearly independent. If none can be represented as a linear combination of the others, so it can be seen, it can be told as these vectors are linearly independent. Now what is the triangular equality, or what is the triangle inequality? In that triangle inequality, you can say that the last one, that here in this particular diagram, you can see that mod of V1 and V2 if less than equals to separate modulus V1 and the separate modulus V2, then this is called the triangular inequality. So if two vectors, suppose V1 and V2, if we are adding their sum, okay, and if we are taking their individual modulus and their sum, so finally what you can conclude, that if two vectors are added and taking the modulus as a sum, and finally if it is compared with these two vectors again having their individual modulus sum, so obviously they are not equal, because the triangle law says that the summation of two arm is obviously greater than the third arm. So therefore the triangular equality says that V1 V2 summation and mod is must be less than equals to their individual summation of the modulus. Okay, so here we are going to that Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. What is this? In the same way what I have shown in that triangle inequality, in that Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, it has been shown that two vectors, if dotted, and after dot if you are taking their modulus, it must be less than equals to of that separate modulus dotted of that given vectors. It means V1 and V2, if taking separate modulus as V1 mod and V2 mod, after that if they are being dotted, what is the value? It must be greater than equals to the individual if dotted, and finally that product is taken as a mod here, V1 dot V2 mod. So obviously the left hand side is less than equals to the right hand side. So here the inequality holding only if V1 equals to AV2, then only. Otherwise, if two vectors are linearly represented, so only it can be applied on this, otherwise it is not applied. Now the norm square. So what is the norm square? Here the individual, if you are taking as V1 plus V2 whole mod as a square, so it can be written as V1 square plus V2 square plus 2 V1 V2 normal A plus B whole square form. Now what is the Pythagorean property? It means if we are taking that V1 square plus V2 square, it must be V1 V2 whole square. So obviously Pythagorean property, you know that the that A and B, if those two arms are perpendicular to each other, so if you are taking their square and adding them, so obviously it will coming as a third arm. So obviously AC square equals to AB square plus BC square. In the same way, two vectors, if V1 and V2, I can write it as V1 square plus V2 square of that mod whole square equals to V1 square plus V2 square. The same thing which is applied to the triangle equality. So here the matrix transformation with respect to matrix A, we can again write that V1 equals to A of V2. So they must be linear in nature. Now here the eigenvalues with respect to that matrix A, that solution of lambda of the determinant A minus lambda I must be equals to 0, where I is a eigenvalue or the eigenvector. Now the eigenvectors with respect to the eigenvalues, the solution of V only for AV equals to lambda gamma. So in this way you can easily find out the eigenvectors and eigenvalues of that matrix, but here it is not required for you. Now in that next class we'll come to that signal space concept for the continuous function. So what is the signal space concept for the continuous function? I'll come to the next class.